Good evening. I'm Nancy Ingram, Vice Chair of the Board of Trustees at Johnson County Community College. If you would join me for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you very much. We do have four trustees present here this evening. I understand Trustee Rattan will be a few minutes late. She is on her way. We also have two trustees with Zoom, and I see Trustee Cross, our chair, so I'll go ahead and turn the meeting over to you.
Thank you, Vice Chair Ingram, and I apologize I'm not able to attend in person tonight, but I'd like to welcome everyone to the March 16, 2023 Johnson County Community College Board of Trustees meeting, and I'll call the meeting to order. If we have four there, we have two here as a matter of roll call, so thank you, Trustee Ingram, for that. And our first item on the agenda tonight is a student spotlight, and I will turn it over to Dr. Bound.
All right. Thank you, Trustee Cross. This evening, as always, it's a pleasure for me to invite you to get to meet one of our students. And tonight, our student is Percy Roberts. And so, Percy, if you'd like to come and introduce yourself, and then we'd like to engage with you in conversation.
My name is Persephone Roberts, though most people call me Percy because Persephone is a bit long. I'm the president of Model United Nations here at JCCC. And Model UN really is more than just a club or an organization to me. It's where I feel most seen and known by people. The friends that I've made and continue to make through are some of my favorite people in the whole world, and I'm actually going to be in the Vice President's wedding this October, and he will be in line next year. So outside of Model UN, I am most often found playing piano, cello, guitar, or violin, and I'll be attending KU in the fall for anthropology. Out of all my JCC experiences, though, I keep coming back to Model UN, and I will never forget the love that I have for it, the gratitude I feel for my Model UN friends, the advisor, Dr. Wright, and all of those who have supported me in being the president and joining this organization, you know, in the first place. Thank you. I yield to the floor for questions.
I'd like to ask a question, if I could. I don't know if I'm looking for Lieb, but we talk about Model UN. I think a lot of people don't know what it is. When you go compete, what do you do?
So what a conference will look like is it's typically a 9 to 14 hour day. And we play or simulate the United Nations in of itself. And a lot of time we are working directly with United Nations delegates and representatives. And we actually have a conference next month from April 7th to the 14th in which we're going to be in New York City. We are going to be all of us representing Belgium on different committees. Personally, I'm going to be on the Commission for Population and Development. And what we do with that is we go into our own committees, so CPD for me, and we have studied and researched Belgium's policies, both domestic and foreign, and we take the research of those policies and then proceed to simulate as a Belgian delegate in those committees.
So it's an international.
Yes.
You learn a lot about not just that country, but other countries that you aren't working on. I think it was people have asked me about it. They know, they hear it, they think it's a great program, but they don't really know what it does. So thank you so much for being part of it.
Yeah.
Any other?
Thank you, Trustee Musil. Go ahead, Trustee Ingram.
Yes, Trustee Smith-Herbert.
Hi, thank you so much for coming. I heard you say something along the lines like you felt like you were really seen or belonged with this particular group. Can you elaborate a little more on what that feels like and what it took for you to feel that in that place with this group?
Yeah, and I would say how it started initially was one of the other Model UNers, her name is Kayla. She's one of my best friends in the whole world. And she kind of just like ushered me into the group of people and just kind of introduced me to everyone. And I use they, them pronouns, so she was kind of making sure that everybody was using my correct name and pronouns. And I mean, a lot of people in Model UN, especially this year, are queer or LGBTQ, and I feel very seen by that because I am, you know, queer. And so I feel like Dr. Wright especially gives a lot of space for people just to kind of be themselves and just to kind of see where they fit in with the international community. And it's just, it's really cool because everyone in there just kind of loves everybody else.
Very cool. Thank you for that. Yeah. Thanks for being here.
Anyone else? Trustee Cross, do you have anything?
I don't have anything, no.
Okay. I think the one thing that I would just share is I think it's really exciting. I'm one of those people still on Facebook, and Dr. Wright does a lot of posting on Facebook about what you do. And for some, you know, it's just, it's interactive, and I feel like, you know, I can always provide a compliment or a thank you, you know, that I know that he's doing a really good job with that program. So, you know, I appreciate that very much. It's just exciting to see what all you're involved in. So
yeah,
we appreciate you being here this evening.
Yeah.
Thank you, Percy.
The next item on our agenda is the open forum, and I apologize, I don't know how many participants we have.
No, that's fine. Because we don't have anyone here this evening for open forum.
I will say, as some memorized part of the usual spiel, that registrants need to register in person 15 minutes outside the door of our meeting, or they can register the day before for Zoom if they're going to be remotely. It's important that everyone remains polite and civil at all times, and that personnel decisions not be brought up, or that questions be brought up with the appropriate college department so that they can be handled accordingly. Seeing how we have nobody signed up for today, thank you, Trustee Ingram. The next item on our agenda are the board reports, and we'll begin with the student senate report by Daniel Gonzalez.
And actually, I would say the student senator was not able, the chair of the student senate is not able to be with us this evening. And so the board report is on SharePoint for everyone.
Well, thank you for that. The next item on our agenda is the college lobbyist report by Dick Carter. I believe I saw him here as a participant on Zoom.
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Chair. And thanks for allowing me to join by Zoom. Right now, the Senate is debating its version of the budget, for which there are some interesting things that I'll provide an update on, sort of real time, if you will, and bring you up to speed on a few other things happening with higher ed. Maybe spring break in most areas of the state, but the legislature is continuing its work through the end of March before taking its version of spring break for most of the month in April. And that's always been the case with that body and how things work with the legislature. So we're working straight through and continuing the work. Like I said, the Senate is currently debating its version of the state budget. So let's talk about the higher education portion of that. Almost everything that was for higher ed in the governor's budget recommendations have been pushed off to omnibus for discussion. So that means we'll be talking about higher ed budget issues in earnest for the Senate version when legislators return at the end of March, beginning of April. Rather, the end of April, beginning of May. That's when we'll be talking about higher ed in the Senate version of the budget. There is a separate bill in the Senate. It's Senate Bill 203 that would fund deferred maintenance at community colleges to the tune of about $100,000 per year for 12 years. You can figure out that math. We've never really seen anything like that as far as a deferred maintenance building fund allowance from the state general fund for community colleges. We're also not sure what strings may come attached with that once the rules and regulations are provided after the bill passes. I think that it's probably a little bit of a carrot to get buy-in from all stakeholders, since the bill also allows for the construction of new buildings, and this bill would be used to also help fund and build effort between KU Madison and Wichita State University in Wichita. So we will continue to watch what goes on there. I'll talk a minute about a couple of provisos that are very concerning. Real quick, Just while we've been, just before we joined this meeting, there was an attempt to cut 2% across the board. That motion failed in the Senate. And there was an attempt to remove the DEI proviso, and that's what I'll talk about here just shortly. That motion also failed 11-25 on a roll call vote. Real quickly, the House budget snapshot, and we now believe that the House will take up its budget next Thursday. Earlier, we thought that it would likely happen again in the omnibus session, but we're hearing now that the House should have their work put together and be able to debate it next week before that second turnaround period and before the first adjournment of the legislature. Of the $107 million recommended by the governor's initial budget recommendations for higher ed, community colleges continue to receive the $6.5 million that I reported earlier in January and February. 5% increase for personnel, rising personnel costs for tiered, non-tiered, and Senate Bill 155 courses. So that would be, it's under $1 million, but we would see some additional dollars flow from that addition by the House. And then restoration of the $3.8 million capital outlay that was intended to be ongoing, but was not included in the governor's budget recommendations. That has been included in the House version. There's still a number of other areas that remain unfunded, and I think that those conversations will likely occur in the omnibus session. Attached to both of the funding plans, both in the House and the Senate, are two provisos that have impacts related to diversity, equity, and inclusion. And in the Senate, the effect would be that no expenditure shall be made by any post-secondary educational institution from monies appropriated from the state general fund or any special revenue fund or funds to compel, require, induce, solicit, encourage, or coerce any applicant, employee, student, or contractor to endorse any ideology, including DEI, or provide preferential consideration to any applicant, employee, student, or contractor on the basis of such person's provision of an unsolicited statement of a commitment to an ideology. There's another requirement in that proviso that would compel the general counsel of each institution to transmit a written report on such institution's compliance annually. These are fairly restrictive provisos. Again, like I said, there was an attempt to remove that proviso a little bit ago in the Senate, and that failed on a roll call vote, which means that is a recorded vote on the amendment and what the amendment attempted to do, and it failed 11-25. The House has a similar version, but is a little bit more flexible. It allows or requires compliance with federal law, including anti-discrimination law. So I think that helps solve a number of issues. Still as troubling and problematic as we move through the budget process, that both of those items are included or attached as strings to receiving any state dollars. So you can see that the issues that we face at the legislature, just trying to move our institutions forward, sometimes are significant and difficult to work with. To take things a bit further, there continues, or at least there appears to be starting a thread that is developing over the rethinking of higher education. And some of the topics that are being discussed, and these are not reports, there's not a bill, there's not a proposal. These are just some of the conversations that we're beginning to hear as additions to conversations that would include efficiency. Nobody can argue with that. Talking about the upcoming enrollment cliff in 2025, 2026, and overall reorganization. Like I said, there's no details, there's no bills, there's no formal proposals. These are just rumblings that begin to take on a life of their own. I guess I would suggest that this information will or should elevate the discussion within the two-year sectors and all of higher ed for that matter, in a manner that we position ourselves in a proactive manner rather than reactive. And I know that at least the folks that help advocate for the two-year sectors, having just heard some of these things this week, have already begun having some of those discussions that obviously will take place at a much higher level than just the three of us, four of us that are over here advocating on behalf of community colleges in the State House. Let's quickly review, because I think there'll probably be some questions. Let's quickly review where a few things are that I've been following and reporting on related to higher ed specifically. The Technical Education Authority Reorganization Bill, which was in Senate Bill 48, did not meet the requirements of the turnaround deadline. So that bill itself, the issue is not dead. The bill itself would require some special rules to revive it, if you will. The bill has been sitting in committee since a hearing earlier this session, but there has been a renewed interest on at least looking at some of the reorganization efforts in this group. Could solidify community college representation in an ex officio capacity, could create term limits for the TEA members that are currently not in place, and probably most importantly would put in place guiding factors such as looking at and placing a priority on high demand and emerging technologies as part of the focus of the TEA. Don't know if we'll see some action on that next week or not. Again, that those are just some of the things that we're beginning to hear that are kind of coming into play. Things always get weird as the session draws to a close, and that's one of those things that we're seeing some movement on. I've talked a lot about the film industry tax credit bill. We have weighed in on that. The House Taxation Committee held a brief hearing on Senate Bill 91 and will likely vote on that bill today. They could have been doing that earlier this afternoon. They've likely adjourned for the day in that committee. I'll have to look online and see if they took any action on that bill. Another bill that was pre-filed before the legislature ever even came into session, and one that we've been following, is the continuation of the reimbursement to the counties for the cost of the printing and mailing of the revenue neutral statements. That bill moved through the process fairly quickly and has been sitting on general orders for most of the session. That bill was passed by the House 114-7, and we'll have a hearing in the Senate Tax Committee on Monday of next week as committees race to finish up their work before they're on the floor all day long working on respective bills from the other House. The CNA training hours is another issue that we've talked about, the reduced hours. That bill did not meet the muster of the turnaround deadline. That bill is dead in the committee in which it resides, but we're also hearing that it could come back to life in some form of other proposals that are moving through the Health and Human Services Committee. Finally, as far as bills go, the Kansas Promise Act amendments are something that we've been also working on over here in Topeka. As you'll recall, they add transportation to the logistics field and add secondary education to the one of the five areas that are eligible in the Kansas Promise Scholarship Act. Both Heather and I met with the majority leader, Chris Croft, to request that bill come above the line for debate. It has been passed out of committee. It sits on general orders. It's the number two bill under the line. And we had a general discussion, a good discussion and agreement that pending no reports of controversy connected to the bill, that we would get that above the line. That was early this week. We're still waiting to see that bill come above the line and continue our communications with House leadership. So we're coming up on some deadlines. March 24th is the last day for bills to be considered by non-exempt committees. March 29th is the last day for bills to be considered in either chamber before we have the drop dead day, which is April 6th. So we're kind of moving that direction over the course of the next 2 weeks. And I think that would be a good place to stop and see what kind of questions I may have generated.
Thank you, Dick. Any questions for Mr. Carter?
Chair Cross?
Yes.
Well,
Mr. Musil.
Dick, I want to make sure I understood, and I understand that committees are racing to do something, and yet higher ed will be put off to the omnibus, which is around May 1st or May 1st, couple weeks in May. So it's always frustrating to think of the legislature as racing when anything truly important is not done until the last wee hours of the morning, it sounds like. But with respect to the DEI proviso, did I understand that that prohibited the use of state general fund revenues for any of those extremely broad and undefined terms that you mentioned?
And special fund revenues, that's correct, yes.
So the 68% we get from property taxpayers of Johnson County and the 18% we get from students would not be covered by that?
I don't know if those are considered any of the special revenue funds, and I probably would want to, I don't think she's probably prepared to respond to this tonight, but I've begun the conversations with general counsel to see how those apply to our funding sources at the college. I like the direction you're going. I'm not sure if we're in the clear.
Well, I guess my point is symbolism is a wonderful thing, and that's what all of these are. And I don't think they will change our view of the world. Number one. Number two, all of these efforts are something we have historically fought against as Johnson County Community College Board of Trustees because they impinge on local control and the ability of Johnson County citizens to control their community college. And so I would hope we would continue to do that wherever we go on DEI or some other policy. I've gotten in trouble on the right because I supported our own ability to determine whether guns were on campus. And I've gotten in trouble on the left because I supported local control when it came to due process for our faculty. But I've tried to be very principled, and I think we need to be very careful about these kind of steps. And $100,000 a year for 10 years for 19 community colleges for deferred maintenance?
It's per college.
What?
Per college.
Per college, okay. It's still almost immaterial for Johns County Community College, and what it amounts to is what we have worried about, the spreading of state funds across the state in a manner that's unequal and non-uniform to Johnson County Community College. Because we get $100,000 and the other 18 schools get $100,000. And we do a good job on not having deferred maintenance. So these things trouble me, and I know I know we don't know anything till the end of the session, but I think the effort to continue local control is something that you take every day up there and that Kate Allen and Dr. Bound take up there, and that we ought to continue to do that. It struck me as I was listening to you that we are not to encourage any ideology. You have a flag behind you that I would fight and die for. We have a flag in this room that I would fight and die for. And we pledge our allegiance to it at the start of every meeting. That's the kind of contradictory symbolism that is causing too many problems in our society, and I hope as this board we will fight against it. Thank you.
Thank you, Trustee Musil. As well said. Nancy, is there anyone else there that has any questions for Dick?
I don't see any.
Do you have anything, Nancy? Sorry?
I can't see Trustee Rail, though.
I can. I don't see her hand up, so I... If I see her hand up.
There, I see. Okay, thank you.
And now I see her. Dick, I just have the CNA hours, CNA training hours, it didn't meet a procedural requirement, correct?
That is
with
correct.
Respect to turnaround day. Is there still an underpinning for it?
There is still a desire out of the South Central Kansas area to move that initiative forward.
And it's mostly because of a shortage of medical workers.
It is, and there's a couple of programs in some hospitals in Wichita that would take advantage of that.
I'm troubled by it. I know we have strategic allies and partners that are not big fans of it, but I think it's a good faith effort in order to broaden the availability of medical care, right? I don't perceive there to be any, you know, profiteer or ulterior motive here other than to just have healthcare available to rural South Central Kansas. Is that too naive or I'm trying to understand the motivation.
I think what I would say is there are a number of efforts and initiatives and not all of them do we see come before the trustees because they're in other areas that we might not observe or follow. There are a number of initiatives that seek to reduce regulation, reduce training, increase responsibilities, if you will. So it's not just the issue of the allied health field. We're seeing this across the board in a number of distribution areas.
Well, thank you for that. Just briefly, with respect to extended bill, I think it was 48, another bill that didn't meet the turnaround requirements, if I took my notes right.
You did.
And, you know, I interned in the legislature. I have some idea, but I'm still fuzzy. It was 20 some years ago. No bill is essentially dead, right? And I think you alluded
to that. Nothing ever dies.
And that's a fairly recent phenomenon, but all of these things could still haunt us in the later stages and even in the executive session, the veto session, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. I could talk all night, but unless there's any other questions for Mr. Carter, we'll move on. Dick, that's a great tie, by the way.
Thank you.
The next item on our agenda is a report from the Faculty Association by Amanda Glass.
This is already on and everything,
yep.
Right?
Yep.
Sorry. So I have to share that I represented the FA in San Francisco this last weekend, and I took my kids cold with me and was fine, and then while I was there in air travel. So I sound awful. So I apologize. There's something you can't understand. I will try to speak slowly so you can understand me. Thank you, Trustee Cross, for the introduction. Hello and good evening. My name is Amanda Glass. I'm an associate professor of chemistry, and I'm the UNISERV representative for the Faculty Association here at JCCC. It is my honor and privilege to get the opportunity to share about some of the things that faculty have been doing here and are planning over the next couple of months. Our faculty are scholars and are passionate about their fields and the success of our students. So I just told you I returned from San Francisco on Sunday, where I represented JCCC and higher ed at the National Education Association Leadership Summit. The theme for the summit was joy, justice, excellence, the strength of educators, the brilliance of students, and the power of community. I attended sessions ranging from how to be an anti-racist educator, environmental and climate justice, and how to effectively facilitate difficult conversations. Plenary speakers included the founder of Donors Choose, his name is Charles Best, and a 13-year-old disability justice warrior, Helena Donato Sapp. She was probably the most credentialed person in the room at all of 13 years old. If you look her up on YouTube, I highly recommend it. She's just a super cool human. Last fall, a group of about 15 volunteer faculty, staff, and administrators began facilitating monthly safe zone training. So in addition to my work as a faculty member in chemistry, I'm also an advisor for the Gender and Sexuality Alliance, our queer group on campus. So a part of that, I decided to help us bring Safe Zone back. It's a national queer allyship curriculum that is available for free. And we have worked over the past year and a half to tailor it to the needs of our community and continue to offer monthly 3-hour sessions. An additional piece that I've worked on specifically is, and added to the curriculum, is the development of a community here specifically at JCCC, a Safe Zone community, where we will publish a directory for that's student-facing, that have resources available for students and for the people who undergo the training. So with all of these efforts, I always say if a group of us do a little bit of effort, then we can really support our students and our faculty and our staff and administrators appropriately. So I'm really excited about that. We've put it out on Get Involved, which is where student clubs and orgs has their stuff. So it's student-facing. So students will be able to access the directory, and then we can also publish things out there that are more for the people who have been trained. It's one of those things that nobody's an expert in this in terms of the people who are doing the training, so we want to make resources available to people so they feel like they can be as supportive and helpful as necessary. I often remind my colleagues that this work is suicide prevention, so statistics tell us that asking and properly using pronouns cuts suicide by 50%. Now, you might ask why this is particularly relevant or important. Nearly 20% of Gen Zers identify as members of the queer community, according to the 2022 Gallup survey. In total, not including the facilitators, 52 JCCC faculty, administrators, and staff have been safe zone trained, and we have people signing up for the monthly sessions as we speak. So I'm really excited and proud of that. In addition, so Honors Faculty Fellows is a new program. I'm lucky to be one of the three Honors Faculty Fellows, and our responsibility is to really be on the cutting edge of what's happening on campus, thinking about things from the Honors perspective. The three fellows were selected because we are from different disciplines and divisions. So I'm Amanda Glass in Chemistry Science Division. We have Danny Alexander in English, and we have Terry Easley Geraldo, who's in Communication Studies. We are all teaching classes in Honors, and we all are developing a project for Honors. It's a three-year fellowship. Our projects are to contribute directly to the development of the Honors program with an eye on its sustainability and to possible contributions to the rest of the institution as a whole. We work to plan the future of Honors at JCCC as exemplified by an extended discussion of various aspects of the recent thing we've been talking about is ChatGPT and artificial intelligence. One of the people who came in to talk with us was Dr. McLeod, but we're thinking about this from multiple lenses and facets, so impact on learning and faculty planning, impact on assessment, impact on the institution at large, thinking about transfer credits, and then something we're always thinking about in terms of ethics, so the ethical ramifications and questions that come up. Just last week, Trustee Rattan and Dr. McLeod visited Dr. Liker's African American Studies class. He asked them to come in and talk about their educational journeys. Now, I feel weird talking to the two of you about what you did, so I'll give Professor Liker's perspective. You're welcome to, I'll tell you, you can ask them questions, but I suppose you should ask them if you can ask them questions. But to talk about their educational journeys and led them to how they're where they are today. Jim felt that the visit went well, students listened attentively and asked good questions. And a big takeaway for him was that trustees and administrators in general rarely get opportunities to interact with students outside of arranged settings when everyone is behaving their best. So seeing them in our labs or in our classroom gave them the perspective to sort of see how we see students on a daily basis. So to see how education really works at JCCC. And again, you can probably ask those two how they felt. Hopefully it was a correct assessment. Ty Edwards is, JCCC is hosting the Kansas Association of Historians Conference here at JCCC at the end of the month, March 31st through April 1st. This is because Ty is the president of the Kansas Association of Historians. So when you're the president, you get to, your home institution gets to host it. This is the fourth time that JCCC has hosted it. The last time was in 2017 when Jim Liker was the president. Serving as host of this long-running conference is part of JCCC's strategic plan to center community partnerships and to be a convener for issues that transform and strengthen our communities. The historians in attendance study many historical topics, and yet they all have some connection to Kansas. Some live here, and others study this. Well, I'm adding wonderful place, I meant. I've only not lived in Kansas for 4 years, so Kansas is a great place. And again, that's at the end of this month. And the conference has existed since 1927, so it's a long-standing conference. April 26th from 6:30 to 9, Latinidad is being offered at JCCC. It is hosted by LUNA, Latinos United Now and Always. They have hosted a Latinidad Week of various events every spring to honor and celebrate Latino culture. This spring, the big event is the Latinidad Leadership Dinner, also sponsored by Promotores, with keynote speaker Saul Flores. Saul will be giving his Walk of Immigrants speech, which shares his three-month journey of walking from Ecuador to Charlotte and the struggles immigrants face. The two advisors for LUNA are Terry Easley Geraldo of Communication Studies and then Melissa Jimenez in Student Life. I can't think of what her actual title is, but she's over staff on the Student Life side. The dinner, I'm really excited. I hope you all buy your tickets. The dinner is Wednesday, April 26th. Registration is free for high school and JCCC students and $30 for community members. Dinner will be from Taco Naco, which I hear is delicious, and there will also be music. We look forward to what is going to be a wonderful event. A couple of weeks ago, we had our latest college scholars talk. You all are kind of terrifying to talk to. So. I was just telling somebody else that the last meeting I said you have to practice public speaking to get it, and then the universe told me that I had to give this the next day. So it was like, That was definitely karma coming back at me. My mom is actually a college public speaking professor, and people think that because she's a public speaking professor that I'm supposed to be good at it and love it. She'll probably watch this, so I'll hear her critique. I send it to her, and she can give it to me based on her rubric. Sorry. So college scholars, there's been four of the five talks have happened. So Christy Howell, back in December, gave the talk, The Bubble, Inside a Bubble, Johnson County Community College. In February, David Vanderham of Humanities gave the talk, Impressive, The History of Virtuosity and Why We Care About Musical Skill. Then, like I said last week, Kevin Caldwell talked about from Academic Support, talked about philosophy in prison, the love of knowledge and community engagement. And Dennis Arjo will be wrapping up that series of talks in April with the title of his presentation being Academic Freedom in the Midst of a Culture War. I talked about the Honors Faculty Fellows. There's also the Faculty Development Fellows and the Center for Teaching and Learning. So this is laying the foundation and setting expectations for creating a long-term sustainable Center for Teaching and Learning at JCCC. They're continuing to offer regular programming, including their Beg, Borrow, and Steal roundtables. Faculty member leads a discussion about different teaching and learning topics. Recently, they've worked with EdTech to develop sample home pages in faculty Canvas course shells. They're working very hard on developing teaching tracks, which will be piloted with next year's full-time faculty orientation. Many of us know it as LENS. The model will retain the cohort aspect. So those of us who are faculty know, I call it our freshman group, we know our LENS group. So they're not changing that cohort style, but they also want to allow faculty members to continue to create this cross-disciplinary connections, but allow new hires the flexibility to take access wherever, to whatever level of training that they need at the point in their career where they're at. So it's kind of like using the flipped classroom model for this, and it will be ultimately scaled up and eventually available to all JCCC faculty. I'm super excited about that. They're collaborating with faculty development, staff development, and others to develop an online training handbook, which is a huge task. And so it's something that's a work in progress, but it's something that eventually will be available to all JCCC employees. And then the last update for the Center for Teaching and Learning is that there's still no physical space. So although a lot can be accomplished on Zoom, we all know this, right? A lot can be done on Zoom. They're having a physical space where people, faculty, can gather in person, whether formally or informally, will allow more opportunities for cross-disciplinary connections and collaborations. This is important because research shows that fostering such faculty connections leads to enhanced student learning at the institutional level. And then the last thing that I want to brag about, I suppose, that's what I get to do today, is talk about the STEM Poster Symposium. And I just saw Lori Slavin about this, and I was like, what's new, Lori? What's new this year? Because it's something that they've been working on since 2017. This year, it's Thursday, April 17th in the CoLab. I asked her about Evolution. The first year, they had one sponsor. This year, they have 13 sponsors.
Wow.
They're hoping to offer 5 to 7 scholarships, at least one of which will be at least $1,000. So this, the scholarships and the raising of money is just growing. The thing that they're adding this year is that there will be a scholarship reception on Dead Day. So May 8th, the people who receive the scholarships will get the opportunity to get back together and to celebrate their hard work. And then I asked her how many have not many have submitted yet, but academics are deadline driven, which is to say procrastinators, which is to say we're not to the deadline yet. But last year there were over 150 posters presented. So I would imagine there'll be at least that many, if not more, this year.
Thank you, Professor. Nancy, who has questions there?
Yes, go ahead. Trustee Rutan.
I have a few questions. For the poster symposium, I had it from March 27th. I may have the date wrong. And there's no April 17th. April
27th.
April 27th. Okay. I heard April 17th, and then I had March 27th.
No, I could have said the wrong number.
So. Okay.
Pretty sure it's April 27th. I can get back. Okay, cool.
And on the Latina Dot dinner, it's on the 26th.
The night before.
Okay, and it's at?
It is at the big, what is it called? The big room at the basement of the Rainier Center?
Cafe.
Thank you. It's a group presentation, right? Thanks, friends. It's in the big room. Yes, there's a limited number of seats, so I would go out and RSVP soon.
Okay, and where do you RSVP?
There was a link sent out on InfoHub.
I will include it in my weekly update.
Okay,
thank you. I was going to say, I can email it to you.
and then finally, I'd just like to say, I am sure Dr. McLeod is also grateful for the opportunity to visit classrooms. We know it's a little bit of a disruption in the curriculum, but it fills me emotionally, and I really love it. I love that I'm invited to it. I've also been to Dan Owen's class as well, and it just is very inspiring to interface with the students, and it really drives home the mission of why we're here. So thank you to all the instructors who've extended that invitation.
I'm glad to get you a lab coat and goggles anytime you want to come.
I'm a little rusty.
I usually get that, and people are like, can I have goggles? I'm like, sure.
I'm a little rusty, but
yes. Yes. Yes.
Trustee Smith Everett.
I just want to thank you for coming tonight, representing the Faculty Association, but also I think what's hard from the dais is understanding the tapestry and the richness of all the ways, the interconnectedness of our community and all the different things we do. So you really provided such a beautifully vivid picture of so many interwoven parts, all linking back, of course, for your purpose, to faculty, which affects the students and their experience, and we're so grateful. So thank you so much for that. Thank you.
I will just interject that I wish you'd been my chemistry teacher. I had lots of chemistry in college, and I don't think I had anyone as exciting as you might be in the classroom. So thank you very much. Trustee Cross, I don't know that there's anyone else who has anything. I think we've done a nice job of complimenting and letting her know how much we appreciate her report.
I thank you. I think you could tell Amanda that Greg Neal would say that I'm rarely on my best behavior. So please don't be that intimidated by us. And thank you for speaking out for the last least and lost among us to give them a voice so that they can understand basic principles, like if somebody has one person to talk to, that reduces suicide risk and the proper use of pronouns and why it's so important. It's not some woke or mythical standard, that it is very real and backed up by things like science and social science research to help our students achieve better. So thank you for bringing that up. I don't have anything else. Nancy, Professor Glass, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The next item on our agenda will be a report on the Johnson County Education Research Triangle, and I turn it over to the man, the myth, the legend, and the former congressional candidate, Greg Musil.
Wow.
Lord, have mercy. The Johnson County Education Research Triangle is funded by a 1/8 cent sales tax approved by the voters in November of 2008. It funds the KU Cancer Clinic, the KU Edwards campus, and the K-State Olathe campus. As I've reported in the past number of months with inflation, our sales tax dollars have gone up as well. The month from January and February of 2023, we're 6.4% ahead of 2022. And as you may recall, 2022 was significantly ahead of 2021 because of price increases. So we are continuing to fund those three legs of the JCCC stool. And I don't know when the next meeting is. I know it's in May, but I don't remember. If anybody wants to know, I will get that to Dr. Bound to put in his report. That's all I have.
Thank you. Chair. Thank you, Trustee Musil. Those numbers, and you may have sent them and I missed it, we're ahead of inflation with the increases. Is that right?
Well, I suppose it depends on what spot of inflation you try to pick, but whatever inflation is out there in retail consumer goods that are a sales tax, we are reaping the benefit of that because we get another percentage. Our eighth of a cent is a bigger percentage as prices go up. So I think this is one area where you can say we are keeping up with inflation, and we need to make sure that the JCCC board's duty is to make sure that the three institutions are spending it as the voters approved in 2008.
I appreciate that. I wasn't trying to trap you at all. I think it is a relative, positive and somewhat positive indicator. So Thank you. Trustee Musil, the next item on our agenda is a report for the Kansas Association of Community College Trustees. Trustee Ingram.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I really don't have anything to report. We have not met. We do have an upcoming meeting in April. It will be Friday, April the 15th. Community college presidents and liaisons are invited to the PTK luncheon that will be held in Junction City. So I'm sure next month at our board meeting, I will have a full report. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That was a great luncheon, I think, for the first time in Junction City last year, and I'm looking forward to it this year. So thank you for reminding everyone. The next item on our agenda is a foundation report by Mrs. Rattan.
Good evening. The report for March is that, again, the 2023 Some Enchanted Evening Gala will be on November the 11th of 2023. We have an exciting announcement for a scholarship partnership with McCarthy Auto to provide 10 scholarships annually to our Auto Tech students. McCarthy Auto will be making an annual $10,000 gift to support the scholarship well into the future. The foundation spring semester scholarships are being awarded, and the 2023-2024 scholarship application for JCCC is open. The foundation will be hosting a spring scholarship luncheon. We'd love for trustees to attend and save the date for April the 11th, 2023 at the Capitol Federal Room. More details will be coming soon. Our next executive committee meeting is on March the 21st. Thank you. That's all I have.
Are there any questions? Mr. Chair, I don't see any questions for Trustee Rattan.
I don't see any questions either. Sorry, I was muted. You can see the Zoom gallery, Nancy, is that right?
I cannot see Trustee Rail.
That's fine. She's got a screensaver up. That's fine.
That's fine. No.
The next item on our agenda, seeing no questions, the next item is a report from the College Council by Mr. Jason Arnett. And before he goes, Jason, if I can interrupt you and just say, whoever has worked to set up the microphone at the speaker's podium, it's awesome. It's the best it's ever been in the 10 years I've been participating, so thank you for that.
Way to go, guys. good evening. I'm finding you all less intimidating the more I come, so thank you. The College Council met February 22nd, and Trustee Ingram, I told you we would meet again before tonight, and I was wrong. So next week we're meeting again. So, but I have more than one paragraph for you. Dr. Bowden and Colleen Chandler, the Vice President of Human Resources, came to meet with us and address the internal equity audit that was paused the week prior. We had a really good discussion around that. Everybody seemed to leave satisfied that things were moving forward, however they were moving forward. So updates from council members included a mention of hallway materials being vandalized and a reminder to report such vandalism quickly. To the appropriate authorities. There was a hearty discussion around a recommendation from our communications subcommittee regarding the conversations with Dr. Bound that may see those events occasionally occurring at the West Park or the Olathe Health campus, as well as this campus. I'm sorry, Olathe Health Education Center, I meant to say. And we're looking forward to the results of the employee engagement survey to help us prepare for the work we're planning in the fall on addressing overall communication issues. And I want to let you all know that the discussion around communication issues is getting really, really interesting, and we're talking a lot about how we want to solve these issues going forward. It's a big concern for us, and I'm really proud of everybody on the council, you know, behaving and speaking appropriately. Dr. Baum was a star in that conversation as well, since he was mostly the subject of it. So one of the earliest subjects that was brought to the College Council was a concern about academic integrity, and I've mentioned that here before. There's a subcommittee on the Academic Branch Council that's focused on the subject, and they're investigating the impact of academic integrity on various areas of the campus, and they're having a lot of conversations around AI as well. That committee continues to seek guidance from the campus community and upper administration about how ensuring academic integrity will be prioritized among the college's other goals. I don't know more than that, but it was an update I got from that committee. Professor Glass touched on it briefly, but there's coming back to overall communication, there's a collaboration between staff development, faculty development, and ed tech that's gathering a list of training items for staff and faculty, and they're trying to put everything in one place to facilitate everybody being able to understand what their job is and how they intersect with others. So that's the report from the College Council. If you have any questions, I'll try to answer.
Thank you very much. I see no questions on Zoom. Trustee Ingram, how there?
Yes, Trustee Smith Everett.
Thank you. I'm really glad to hear we're less intimidating, but if we need to hamper down, we can. We can put on the growl faces. Go back to the training for just a minute. Can you elaborate a little more on what, so I always come from the public ed side, and we've moved to a lot of training modules being on Canvas for all employees. So from the cafeteria workers to the principals, all people go to Canvas for their trainings and compliance. Is that the kind of issues that you're talking about? And is it a wide variety of roles, or is it a
There's just
specific
some inconsistencies
group?
When some new employees come on, whether they're in dining or another department. And my day job is in dining services, I apologize.
Never apologize for being in dining services.
No.
You are the most critical.
Properly when I came up. I figure you all know me now. But,
yeah.
No, we're talking about like manager training, supervisor training, okay. You know, onboarding processes, offboarding processes, how to handle your procurement card, you know, and just trying to gather everything all together in one place. So it's easier when you hire a new supervisor or a new director or, you know, anybody, you know, you say, here's a place you can go. Because when you go to the orientation, you get a whole bunch of information in about 4 hours, and you're not going to remember it all. And you may get the PowerPoint that comes back, but it's not going to be everything. It's like, you don't hire somebody maybe in your first week. Mm-hmm. So having that training available to you later on is always helpful. So that's the idea of gathering all that together.
Got it. Thanks so much. Mm-hmm.
Does anyone else have anything? Mr. Chair, I don't see anyone here with further questions.
Well, thank you very much. The next item on our agenda, I believe we turn to the committee reports and recommendations. The first item on the committee reports is the audit committee, and Trustee Ingram, if I may turn it over to you.
Yes, I'm happy to do that. The audit committee met on Wednesday, March the 8th. The committee approved the recommendation of BKD Forvis LLP for audit co-sourcing services, as will be presented by the Management and Finance Committee to the Board tonight for approval. Additionally, the Audit Committee approved the recommendation of Reuben Brown for financial audit services, as will be presented again by the Management and Finance Committee to the Board this evening. Audit presented recent activities, including the audit risk assessment, which is an internal audit, currently working on audit risk assessment that will be used to create the annual audit plan. Bookstore operations and controls audit. Internal audit began an audit of the JCCC bookstore. They are looking at key processes and controls. GLBA risk assessment update. IT is working to complete a GLBA risk assessment. Audit recommendations update. We do have internal audit and IT who gave updates on outstanding issues from prior audits. Progress is being made on action plans and to close findings related to prior audits. An update on ethics line complaints was also provided, and our next audit meeting will be held on Wednesday, May the 3rd, 2023 at 2 p.m. And that concludes the report.
Thank you, Trustee Ingram. I don't see any questions on Zoom. Anything there?
I don't believe so. Thank you.
Thank you very much. The next item on our agenda is the Board Governance Committee report by Trustee Musil.
I I guess I looked at the agenda. I didn't realize I was giving the report. I was not able to make the last meeting, and Trustee Smith Everett chaired the meeting. And basically, we're looking at the evaluation process for the president and put that off till the next month. So I apologize that I had work responsibilities that precluded me from being there, and thank Laura for handling the meeting.
Yes, sorry about that. I was not going to be here this evening, and then my plans changed, and so they gave it to you, and little did you know, here I am.
So we have nothing to report except next month.
I may have misread it. I apologize, and you don't have anything to apologize for, Trustee Musil. You have two terms as chair, and my term is nothing like either of yours, so I appreciate your time. With respect to the next item on the agenda is the collegial steering report. I will give that report here briefly. We had one item on our agenda when we met on April 1st, and it was a shared governance. And myself, Dr. Bound, and Brett Cooper, Andrea View, Judy Korb, Mickey McLeod, and others were there and present as we had a rather lively discussion regarding shared governance and what it meant. Professor Cooper gave us his opinion, his preference that the Faculty Association be included more in the decision-making process, and that governance by definition meant more being involved in more actions, and that that the FA, you know, would prefer that FA leadership is consulted more with respect to decisions that are made, as opposed to individual professors being consulted by the faculty. As I have supported this president, I said, no, you know, I'm not going to take away executive prerogative to consult and execute the business of the college in the manner they see fit. But I have always worked to facilitate communication and shared governance with faculty, and I appreciated the discussion greatly. And welcomed it as a place to come discuss issues that are not only on the faculty's mind, but just at the core of anything that they think we should be doing. And I believe it had started as early as under Dr. Carlson, having a collegiate steering committee, and then either President Callaway or Joe Sopcich revived it. So I find it as a useful meeting. And I will say that I had a lively discussion with the political scientist named Andrea View, Professor View, and she had challenged me to name one, this is prior to the meeting, and just a side note, one leader, one woman politician hadn't been demonized or negatively viewed by public perception. And after, it took me like 2 or 3 days, I was exercising a few days later, and the only anecdote I could come up with was that of, she was former German chancellor, right, Angela Merkel, who was, you know, seen as a strong leader and, frankly, the leader of the free world for a time. So that concludes my report on collegial steering, and I'd gladly take any questions.
Mr. Chair, I do not see any.
Well, thank you very much. The next item on our agenda is the Inclusion and Belonging Committee, and the report will be given by Trustee Rattan.
Good evening again. The Inclusion and Belonging Committee met at 10:40 a.m. on Wednesday, March 1st in the Hugh Speer Boardroom. We talked about monitoring inclusion and belonging strategies and initiatives, and we met, one of our agenda items is to meet with groups on campus. And so Kate Allen introduced Yassine and Anthony, who represented the Student Veterans Association and peer advisors for veterans education programs on campus. They discussed their military backgrounds and the value of inclusion and belonging for students like them here at JCCC. They also expressed that balancing outside obligations with schoolwork is a challenge for those coming back to civilian life as one of the things that differentiates them. Second agenda item, monitoring benchmarking and metrics. We received data on Pell students from John Clayton and Natalie Allman-Byers from the Office of Institutional Effectiveness, Planning, and Research. The discussion focused on the county census data in relation to JCCC's student population, along with the achievement challenges for Pell student population. Bless you. The data was compared with peer institutions from around the country, and we had a really great discussion about that. third agenda item, to monitor inclusion and belonging strategies and initiatives. Trustee Smith Everett introduced a very helpful ACCT checklist, which has benchmarking information on how to support inclusion and belonging initiatives at community colleges. The document introduces steps to design and implement the practices, processes, programs, policies we need around inclusion. And the goal of the checklist is to create an action plan for our Board of Trustees that can support the growth of an equity mindset within our campus culture. Our next meeting will be on Wednesday, April the 5th at 10:30 a.m. right here in the boardroom. Thank you. That's all I have, Chair.
Thank you, Trustee. Any questions for the trustee?
I'm not seeing any, Mr. Chair.
I don't see any. Thank you, Trustee Ingram. The next item on our agenda is a report for the Management Finance Committee. I believe that's by Trustee Musil.
It is, Mr. Chair. And the previous one wasn't your fault. I just didn't read the agenda. When I saw board governance, I knew that Trustee Smith Everett was in charge, so I didn't even look at who was going to make the report. That's my reading comprehension problem. The Management and Finance Committee met at 8:30 a.m. on Wednesday, March 1st, on our committee day. First item was Megan Casey, the Director of Bursar Operations, presented information on how we collect past due fees, tuition and fees, and how we treat students with unpaid balances with respect to access to their transcripts, and changes in policy that are being made throughout higher education, I think, to allow people to transfer, get their transcript, to go elsewhere, or come back to Johns County Community College, and what is in store, I think, for the fall. We also talked about the GEB first floor remodel, which was part of the master facilities plan that we adopted, 2017 or 18, that would transform the building we're in now, GEB, into more of a student-friendly, open, welcoming place for the first floor with student activities and student groups, more so than administrative offices, and that process was discussed, as well as the construction plans and some of the cost information. We also have a couple of agenda or action items tonight, Mr. Chair. The first one is the award of bids for the GEB first floor remodel, including the installation of a fire sprinkler system, which has never been in this building since it was built. We will offer the low bid to GPS Kansas City of $4,363,842.20. It's a recommendation of the Management and Finance Committee that the board accept the recommendation of college administration to approve the low bid of GPSKC for the renovation of the first floor and a new fire suppression sprinkler system in the GEB building in the amount of $3,967,132 with an additional 10% contingency to allow for possible unforeseen costs for a total amount of $4,363,845.20, the low bid, and I will make that motion.
Second.
Motion has been moved by Trustee Musil, and I did not hear the second. I don't know who it was.
Tan seconded, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Trustee. Any discussion?
Clarifying question.
Sure.
This bid is not for the remodel of the GEB. The remodel is the fire sprinkler system.
Now, this is for the construction.
It is the construction.
Construction and deconstruction of various offices here, opening them up for student purposes, including renovation of this room to allow a larger audience area. And it will, if you don't like your somebody to move your cheese, you're not gonna like this, because this room is gonna change into an angle toward the presidential offices, and presidential offices
straight back.
Okay, so that's all part of this.
So it is, okay, I just wanted to clarify, because the way I read it when I first read this, this was just sprinklers, which I thought was rather pricey, but there's a lot of requirements now. Okay,
very
it
nice
is
sprinklers.
The construction and the sprinkler.
It is.
Thank you.
Yes.
Any other discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed? In the opinion of the chair, the ayes have it. Trustee Musil.
The next item for action tonight is a single purchase item of $150,000 or more, which comes to this board. There are three separate bids here, all of which were awarded to the low bidder. So it's a recommendation of the Management and Finance Committee that the Board of Trustees accept the recommendation of college administration to approve the low bids from the following companies: SGI in the amount of $89,520 for the comm building, Martin Mechanical in the amount of $227,074 for the VAV box duct heaters in the Midwest Trust Center, Cosmetology, Career Tech, and Science Buildings, and Associated Air Products for in the amount of $59,454 for the Rainier Center building, with an additional contingency totaling 10%, $37,604.80 to allow for possible unforeseen costs. For HVAC improvements to all these buildings for a total estimated expenditure of $413,652.80, and I will make that motion.
I'll second.
The motion has been moved and seconded. I don't know by who, sorry.
Second by Trustee Ingram.
Thank you. Moved by Trustee Musil, seconded by Trustee Ingram. Any discussion?
If I may, just to clarify, the VAV box, duct heaters, and so forth, that's the Student Center?
Student Center.
Yep.
SC, I went a real abbreviation to science. Okay, so Student Center. Thank you.
I have a brief question. The SGI bid, it's dramatically lower than those other two. We feel it's in line and appropriate.
Tom's coming to the podium, yeah. Mr. Chair.
Tom Hall, Associate Vice President for Campus Services. This bid, the way it was set up, there were several different things we were bidding, and the SGI was the low bid on this piece. The other companies were low bids on the pieces that they're getting award to. So everybody got a piece of the action, and they were all low bids in the area that they bid.
To clarify, I think the question also was about, it seemed lower, noticeably lower than the other bids, and does that cause any concern?
It's different work. Everybody bid on everything. This piece of the work, the lowest bid on this piece of the work was SGI. But everything, they're not comparable pieces of work. They're all different varieties of work throughout. So we took the low bid on each area of the work that was bid.
Okay, I see. So they had, and thank you for that, Tom, they had essentially a total bid, and then you were able to disaggregate it, break it apart, and they just had different amounts bid for different sections, and that was the bid for that section?
Yes. Each section had a separate bid on it.
Oh, okay. No, thank you for that. I just was curious. It's $52,000 lower, $51,000 lower than the other two in that area. And so, I trust you. I'm asking, not to grandstand, but just to make it, look like we're asking you questions. So,
Mr. Chair,
just to clarify, they were the lowest bid on this piece of the work. So
right.
There were several, everybody bid on the same work. Every piece, there were several pieces they were bidding on. This piece of the work, they were the lowest bid on. They weren't extremely a lot lower. They were comparable, but this piece of the work, they were the low bid on this piece.
Madam Vice Chair.
Yes, Trustee Smith Everett has a question.
Sure.
Thank you. I just caught the cosmetology. It just occurred to me that is that in the building that we rent? So we're.
Yes, okay. And the reason for doing this is because the program requires that we add additional ventilation in that area, and it's not really the landlord's responsibility to make sure that we have the additional ventilation for the program. So it's for the safety of our students.
Right, and that is
not
you may not know the answer to this. It's, if my memory serves me right, last year, I thought our lease was going to be up for that. So I'm just double checking that we're not getting ready to do a chunk of work on a building that we won't be at.
No, it's still got a couple more years left on the lease.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Trustee Smith-Everett. Trustee Ingram, any other questions there?
I don't see anyone. Thank you.
Very well.
I do have.
Since there's no.
Excuse me, Trustee Rattan.
But to follow up on your question, I know that Mrs. Corbin and I were also talking about moving cosmetology and what the long-term plans are. Mm-hmm. Would that HVAC system be able to be portable and moved back to here? Is something permanent to the building?
No, this piece is specifically for the ventilation when they're doing the nails, but it would remain with a piece of property, or we'd have to pay additional money to take it out.
Okay. Thank you.
And I might note that the total bid is $249,000, but that includes Midwest Trust Center, Cosmetology, CTEC, Career Tech Ed, and the Student Center. So the amount we're putting in here for a couple of years is not dramatic, but I appreciate the point that we don't want to put permanent things into a building that we're going to lose or abandon in a certain short period of time.
Thank you, Trustee Musil. Any other discussion? Hearing and seeing none, I'll call the question. All those in favor of the motion, please signify by saying yes.
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 And those opposed? In the opinion of the chair, that motion passes unanimously. Trustee Musil.
The next item is a multi-year purchase of $150,000 or more, which comes to this board. This is for an audit co-sourcing services so that an audit firm would assist our internal audit efforts on an as-needed basis as a contractor. Contractor shall provide services as needed at our discretion to perform audit services under the direction of our audit services or information services departments. It is a recommendation of both the Audit Committee and the Management and Finance Committee that the Board of Trustees accept the recommendation of College Administration to approve the proposal from BKD Forvis for audit co-sourcing services for an estimated base year of $100,000 and a total estimated expenditure of $350,000, including renewal options through 2028, and I so move.
I'll second. Ms. Trustee Ingram.
Motion. Thank you. The motion has been moved by Trustee Musil and seconded by Trustee Ingram. Any discussion? I see none on Zoom. Nancy?
No, I don't believe there is any. Thank you.
Hearing and seeing none, I'll call the question. All those in favor of this motion, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
And those opposed? In the opinion of the chair, the motion passes unanimously. Trustee Musil.
The next item is a multi-year purchase, again, over $150,000 that needs approval by this board, and this is to establish a contract for the annual external audit services related to the college's financial statement audit. And as noted in your materials, this does not cover the JCCC Foundation that will presumably use Reuben Brown at a different price. We have used Reuben Brown for a number of years, and they were the low bidder and the winner. It wasn't a bid, it was a request for proposal. So they were selected through a committee process, but also it appears as though they were the lowest price of the qualified respondents to continue to do our annual audit, both for our state purposes and our federal compliance purposes. And so it is a recommendation of the Audit Committee and the Management and Finance Committee that the Board of Trustees accept the recommendation of College Administration to approve the proposal from Reuben Brown for financial audit services for a base year of $100,245 and a total expenditure of $548,530, including renewal options through 2028, and I will so move.
Second.
Yeah, motion.
Hamill.
Thank you. The motion has been moved by Trustee Musil and seconded by Trustee Hamill. Any discussion?
Mr. Chair, I would just mention that having watched Reuben Brown now for a number of years, I know they work well with our staff. I think it's very important that we nonetheless put these professional services out to an RFP. I think our policy is every 3 or 5 years so that we know that they are competitive and we know other businesses have the opportunity to do so. But I think it will be a benefit to our staff to have the continuity with Reuben Brown, and I'm pleased that they were found to be the best qualified and also had the lowest price.
I concur, and moreover, that evaluation committee is one of the most talented in the history of the college, so I don't think that we have too much to worry about. Any other discussion? Hearing and seeing none, I'll call the question. All those in favor of this motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
And those opposed? Hearing no opposition, the motion passes unanimously. Trustee Musil, did you have anything else?
There were two other agreements that the committee looked at. One was kind of an exciting agreement with the National Gallery of Art and the Los Angeles County Museum of Art for an outbound loan of artwork from the Nerman Museum to be displayed and presented at the Los Angeles County Museum of Art. Apparently we have had some of these outbound ones before. This is the first one I remember coming to us, and it's kind of exciting to know that we have such a high quality and sought after art collection developed by private sector funding, not by general tax dollars, and to have that. We also had an agreement with Kansas City Scholars to provide scholarships for adults training in high demand workforce sectors, which I think is our first effort to do adults through the Kansas City Scholars Program. If not, we did some previous work with some grant money, and this is another effort.
On the non-credit side, yes.
On the non-credit side, right.
Short-term training.
And then we had informational items. There were no questions about those. And that completes my report, Mr. Chair.
Any questions for Trustee Musil? Any other questions or comments for Trustee Musil? I'll take the liberty. Thank you, Trustee Ingram. I'll take the liberty, Trustee Musil, just to comment. I concur with you, and I think these two agreements, along with much of the other work at the Nerman and across the college, are beautiful examples of the public-private hybrids that we've worked to set up with relationships that we have, you know, across the county and really even coast to coast, and with Professor Wright really across the globe. So, among others who worked across the globe. So. Unless there's any other questions there, hearing and seeing none, the next item on our agenda is the student success report by Trustee Rep.
Thank you, Chair Cross, and good evening. I apologize that I'm traveling. I have extremely limited bandwidth, so we'll see if I can get through this without freezing several times. The Student Success Committee met at 10 a.m. on Wednesday, March 1st in the boardroom. We were privileged to hear a presentation from Beth Edmonds, Professor of Mathematics, and Sunitha Menon, who's the Director of the Science Resource Center, providing an overview of the JCCC STEM Scholarship Program. That is a grant funded by the National Science Foundation Program, and eligible students enrolling in that program must demonstrate both financial need and academic talent, as well as a commitment to pursuing an associate's degree in a STEM field and intent to transfer to a four-year college. It was wonderful to hear this presentation. It was truly a recipe for student success and really enjoyable to listen to. Track one of this program started in 2015, and track two has now been funded through 2028. Track two increases an emphasis on assisting students transferring to a four-year university. And the components of this program include not only financial assistance, but mentoring, social support services. There are cohort, all of those things together being a chance for student success. A testament to the success of the program is that within 2 years after transfer, 100% of Track 1 students who transferred to a four-year university graduated with a bachelor's degree in a STEM field. To date, there's been just under $1.3 million in scholarship money that's been dispersed over the two grants, We had the opportunity to listen to a video testimonial from a student who has graduated with a bachelor's degree and was one of the first students enrolled. It was really an enjoyable presentation. And I want to thank Professor Edmonds and Sunitha for giving us the opportunity to hear about it. The next Student Success Committee meeting is scheduled for Wednesday, April 5th at 10 a.m. in the boardroom. And Chair Cross, that concludes my report.
Thank you, former Chair Rail. I appreciate it. It's good to see you. And I'm sorry I wasn't here last month for your first meeting, maybe your second meeting, I guess. But at any rate, any questions for Trustee Rail?
So, Mr. Chair, I have a comment.
Yes, ma'am. Trustee Smith.
I'm putting my finger in the air, but I realize you can't see me, so I have to speak up.
I apologize.
No, that's fine. I just wanted to make a comment that about that presentation that was in the Student Success Committee. I am not a member of that committee, but was in the back of the room during the presentation, and it, like many others in the room, was really awed and impressed by all that they do. But more importantly, the success that they have reaped for their students. And I think that that is something that we wish for every student who walks through the doors of JCCC. And I think it's a really important component for us to look at what it takes for that many students to be successful and to meet the goals that they have outlined for themselves, as the student whose video we watched spoke to. She wasn't always on the track that she was going to be successful, but because of all the effort and the mentoring, she was able to be successful. And I just want to tie it back to the rhetoric about DEI, because at its core, that is what DEI is about. It is about making sure that every student gets to meet their goals and is recognized and supported for getting there in whatever way they need, and that every group, makeup, individual that a person carries with them when they come through the doors deserves to be known and understood and supported on the way to those goals. So whatever the national rhetoric might be, and even the local rhetoric, what it really comes down to is student success and ensuring that we are a part of those students' goals. So I just wanted to make that comment at this juncture. Thank you.
Thank you, Trustee Smith Everett. Any other comments, questions for Trustee Rail?
I don't see any. Thank you.
Thank you. Let me move back to my agenda here. The next item on our report, I believe, is the Treasurer's Report, and we're blessed to have Trustee Smith Everett here, so I'll ask her to read it, if I may.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. I was laughing at blessed. You can find the Treasurer's Report on page 18 through 30 of your board packet. It includes the report for the month ended January 31st, 2023. Some items of note include on page 1, page 18, includes the general post-secondary technical educational funds, which are the primary operating funds of the college, an ad valorem tax distribution of $65 million and some change was received from Johnson County in January and recorded as follows. You can see I did not read my report before presenting, Mr. Chairman. The spring disbursement of the college's 2021 state operating grant was also received in January in the amount of $12.4 million. The general fund unencumbered cash balance was $130.7 million as of January 31st. 2023. That is a decrease of $6.4 million from the previous year. This budgeted decrease is due to the renovation of the science and CLB buildings, which is being funded by general fund reserves. Expenditures in the primary operating funds are within approved budgetary limits. It is the recommendation of the college administration that the Board of Trustees approve the treasurer's report for the month ended January 31st, 2023, subject to audit. And I will make that motion.
Second.
Motion has been moved by Trustee Smith Everett and seconded by Trustee Musil. Any questions or comments for Trustee Everett?
Mr. Chair, I would just thank Johnson County property taxpayers for that $65 million worth of confidence in this college. and compare it to the $12 million we got from the state, hearkening back to my earlier comments about who should be able in control of this college. It should be the taxpayers and citizens of Johnson County, and we should recognize that every time we get an ad valorem distribution from that comes from the county treasurer, so that we know where it's coming from and who we're here to serve as a board. Thank you.
Thank you. You're way more articulate than me, and I don't know what's happening here, if I get older or what, but I seem to agree with you more. And before I comment, I will ask, are there any other questions or comments?
You just scared me, Mr. Chair. Maybe I'm coming toward you.
No, well, I guess what I'm saying is, you know, I appreciate your comments greatly, because I think we've always desired to have a strong relationship with Topeka and everyone there. And many of us do on both sides of the aisle. But, you know, I can't imagine it would be a good step in any relationship to take the local control or alienate our tax base in Johnson County and hope to accomplish things statewide. So voting trends are what they are. We all know what they are. And we're certainly glad to have a good relationship with Topeka. We're thankful for $12 million. But on a budget of, I think it was $183 million last year, it doesn't help our students that much, although we are grateful. So at any rate, the motion is, did we vote on the motion, Kelsey?
No.
I don't. Thank you. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
And those opposed? In the opinion of the chair, it passes unanimously. And Trustee Smith Everett, I believe that concludes your report, right?
Yes, it does, Mr. Chair.
And I just want to say thank you. I think Janelle Vogler wrote that for us. She was supposed to be me saying it, so thank you for stepping back in, Trustee Smith Everett. And then Rachel Lears' department, of course, put that together for us. So the next item on our agenda is the President's monthly report to the board, and I will turn it over to Dr. Baum.
All right. Well, thank you, Chair Cross. Appreciate the opportunity to provide an update tonight to all of you. In my report this month, by the way, Trustee Cross, I like that tie. Must be St. Patrick's Day coming up tomorrow. All right.
It must be, and thank you.
In my report, you had the opportunity to spend some time with Persephone Roberts, and I certainly appreciate all that they do to guide our work around United Nations. So with that, let me jump into the remainder of my report. In the report, I think we have lots to celebrate. While I think we always do, there are a number of things that come to mind here in the month of March. In the last 2 weeks, we received notification of first and or ongoing programmatic accreditation. First is the construction management program through the ACCE, or the American Council for Construction Education. Assistant Professor Steve Bennett and Dean Richard Fort and the team there did a fantastic job, and they are initially accredited through 2028 would be when they're up. In addition to that, our dental hygiene program under the leadership of Dr. Carrie Hansen and Dr. Lenora Cook received notification that they had received renewed programmatic accreditation through CODA, which is the Commission on Dental Accreditation. And again, it's a fantastic program, and they do a great job of preparing dental hygienists to serve all of us across our community and region. Recently, in the last couple of weeks, we had student performances on campus, both from students in theater and in music. The theater students performed Wonder of the World, and we had three different music performances by concert and jazz bands, as well as our choir. They'll be performing again late in the semester. Their final performances of the year will be, the theater students, Noises Off, April 21 through the 23rd, or the following weekend, the 28th through the 30th. Those tickets are free and available for everyone to participate. They really do a fantastic, fantastic job. Our music students have three performances, again, the same groups. maybe slightly different, but three performances. Concert band on May 2nd, the evening of May 2nd, jazz on the evening of May 3rd, and the choir on the evening of May 4th. Again, incredibly, incredibly talented students here at Johnson County Community College. With regard to some of our athletic teams, our women's basketball team closes out this point in the season at 32-1 after beating Labette in triple overtime and are now in the entering the national championship tournament next week in Port Huron, Michigan. The men also entered the national championship tournament with a win over Allen last week, and they will be competing next week as well. We're the only Division II team in the nation that has a team in both the men's and the women's tournaments. So great, great success for those teams. Our Golden Girls dance team won the Region 6 title several years running. I imagine it must be a bit unnerving for some of the other teams to realize, oh no, Johnson County Community College is there. They just continue to do a fantastic job. They swept the platform and did very well. They will compete nationally at Nationals in Daytona Beach early next month. And our baseball team is currently ranked number 9 in the nation, and our softball team is undefeated. So again, while we talk about this from performance in competition, remember that our students, 71%, 72% of our students, our student athletes are earning academic honors. And again, athletics for me is certainly about having the opportunity to compete or perform, but it is very much about student success in the classroom. So
when does the JCC jet leave for Daytona Beach so we can all be there?
That's a good question. I believe it will be leaving out of Kansas City International Airport if they don't drive. So I don't know the answer to that question. Also on campus today, I wanted to just draw everyone's attention to the fact that we held the U.S. naturalization ceremony here on campus again. I've been told it's 15 plus years in running that we've been holding this on our campus. We had the privilege of Governor Kelly being the speaker today, and hundreds of individuals became U.S. citizens today. This is a part of who we are as an institution, of welcoming folks to our nation, welcoming them to our region, and serving them well in a variety of ways, and they get a chance to see this special place in a very important day for them. I would like to draw attention to a couple folks in this process. Ann Hunt is someone who works behind the scenes tirelessly and ensuring that events on campus, whether in the Rainier Center or events like today in the Midwest Trust Center, she and her team are instrumental in pulling off absolutely incredible events. And they go 7 days a week, all hours of the day. And I just want to make sure that we recognize Ann and her team for the great work that they do. In addition to today with the governor's presence on campus, that means campus police. Deputy Chief and team did a great job, as they always do, of logistics and keeping not only our people safe here on campus, but our people safe across the community. And I appreciate the work that they did as well today. So, all right, so those are some of the good things that are going on. Let's jump in quickly with some of the other items on the report. In addition to those items, if we look at enrollment, is at about 3951 as of earlier this week for our non-credit students. That's down from about 5,000 at this time last year, but up from where we were in 2021, which is about 3,400 or so at that point. You know, much of this is due to the fact the shift in funding over the last 2 years. We had experienced COVID relief funds that we used to help make training more affordable to folks. And while certainly you have in your packet today in the consent agenda, the $1.2 million of funding through the county to assist with that, you know, we are certainly seeing the impact of that. But again, well on the way to having a very strong semester here in the spring. If we look at non-credit enrollment continues to move in the right direction. 4.7% up over where we were at this point a year ago, and 4.5% in credit hours. Again, I attribute this to the fantastic work of our faculty and staff across campus to really work at not only attracting students, but to work very hard at retaining the students that we have.
Just to clarify, yes. You mean credit, right?
4.7% up in credit headcount. Yes, credit.
This you said
credit
non. You said non. Credit.
I apologize.
But
thank
I thought,
you for clarifying
I was, you
that.
You switched the slide when it was credit.
Yeah. So this is where down year over year in non-credit, we are up year over year for this semester in credit enrollment, both in terms of headcount and in credit hours. Thank you for that clarification. And then I wanted to close out my report tonight by talking about the future and where community colleges, the best of community colleges are heading, and where I challenge us to move. And you've heard me talk about Community College 3.0. I wanted to put a little meat behind it tonight. And we think about Community College 1.0, which is really where community colleges started in the early 1900s as open access institution, giving everyone access to higher education. And in those early days, often started as junior colleges. They were heavily focused on transfer and liberal arts education, preparing students for transfer to a four-year school. But as we moved through the Depression era and through World War II, post-World War II, that focus really began to expand around career and technical education or workforce education, and expanded greatly as a result of the GI Bill. So that is, we started as open access institutions. About late in the 20th century, early in the 21st century, we started to see this shift towards Community College 2.0, looking at both access and completion, that both are important, and really stem from the work that the belief that access without completion, frankly, is a hollow promise, right? Come on here. But if you're not moving successfully through to completion and on to other opportunities, then perhaps community colleges and were missing their mark. And this really began to ring true coming out of research out of the mid-1990s, where you began to see organizations form like the Community College Research Center and Achieving the Dream, two flagship organizations in this country that have really been driving the completion agenda and beyond. We really, at that point, began to focus nationally on developmental education, remedial education. The belief was that if you really focus in on the front end of that and readiness and preparation, if you do those things, that will drive up completion rates, student performance and completion rates. And while it had an effect on it, didn't have the effect that what the hope was as community colleges moved down that path. And so, it's where the next kind of phase of that and where we're stepping into is the work around guided pathways, right? Give students a clear path, help them understand where they're going, make it clear, make it accessible. And that will continue to drive gains in student outcomes. Again, certainly for the institution, but most importantly for the students who are progressing towards completion. And the belief that guided pathways and the work that we have ahead of us is that this is whole institution work. This isn't something that just instructional faculty do, or that counselors do, or that, right? It's when we all come together around driving both access as well as completion. And then finally, we move into to Community College 3.0, and this is where I believe we need to be heading as an institution more fully, and that is around balancing access, completion, and post-graduation success. We know that early program choice, helping make students make good choices early on and giving them good, clear pathways to get there, increases the likelihood of success. We know that students that meander through the process, when while exploration is good, and we support that, we also believe that, I also believe that clarity around where are you going with a clear pathway to get there and the resources to help you do that is what ultimately drives better and better success for our students. And so we need to pay closer attention, not only to access and completion, but where are they going when they leave us? Where do our students go? How do they do when they transfer on to a four-year school? How do they do when they go into the workplace? Are they well prepared for success in that? And so, you know, there are really five bullet points under here that I just want to draw your attention to. It's really around redefining student success. That it's completion to career, and it's completion to transfer to career, depending on the pathway that a student is in. I certainly acknowledge it. Not every student is coming to us with the intent of graduating. But every student comes to us with the expectation they're coming for a reason, and we're part of the solution to a better tomorrow, and that's why they're coming to us. That we need to engage our four-year colleges and universities in improving transfer and graduation rates. And while we don't readily have the available data today, we do have access by working through it through the National Clearinghouse for student data. And we can do that, and we can back into it. It's not as efficient as it could be, but we can get there and see where our students are doing and how they're doing. We need to engage employers in really making sure we have a clear understanding of the goals of talent development, of helping students acquire the knowledge and skills that they need to be successful. That's true both in terms of those that are going to transfer onto a four-year school and then back or into the workplace, or those going directly to the workplace. And that the advisory committees that each of our career and technical education programs have, that we fully engage and make sure that we're engaging employers and understanding what their needs are, that we blend together with that the labor data, right? The employment data and demand in our community as we move forward, and that we make sure that together we have a deep understanding of market demand. That we need to align student advising systems to post-graduation goals. Again, bachelor's degree programs that lead to family-sustaining wages, that help students make good choices early on and throughout their plan, and guidance towards career and technical education programs that increase that relationship between instructional faculty and counselors and student success advocates and so forth, that as we're working together to wrap around the student to be successful, that we have good advising systems to help them do that. And then also for us in understanding from a leadership standpoint, access and what that means and how well we do that, the momentum and progress with a purpose and completion, and then ultimately focusing on post-completion success. Because again, a student's coming to us expecting a brighter future because of their experience here with us. And that's where we need to be heading as a college from your president's perspective. So wanted to close my report with that. So happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Dr. Bound. Any questions for Dr. Bound? Comments?
I have a question, Mr. Chair. And I really appreciate that, your last the last slide, Dr. Bound, and this becomes kind of mundane after that, really more aspirational goal that we need to get. But in the continuing ed enrollment for spring of 2023, we had additional funds last year, which allowed an awful lot of people to take a non-credit course for free because of federal funding, and so we had this big jump. Do we have any metrics or anything that we can look to say, and they did this with that information, and they did this with that, because that to me is, if it's a funding issue, those weren't huge dollars, but if we could, you know, add 1,000 non-credit students every year for a certain amount, that's where you can go for grants or maybe state funding or something to show that this was money very well spent. And that, so I'm just trying to figure out how do we measure the success of getting that additional 1,000 adults in a non-credit course.
So Elisa Wildman, Vice President of Workforce Development and Continuing Education. That is a great question, Trustee Musil. So we do have both anecdotal information. We survey all of the students, ask them what they hope to attain, and then there's a completion survey. We have not all of them fill out the completion survey, but I can absolutely get you some of that information. But more importantly, we are measuring the number of industry certifications achieved by our non-credit students, our continuing ed students. And that number is growing. Again, I don't have the data on me tonight, but we are measuring it, and I can absolutely present that to you.
And I'm not looking necessarily to present it. I just want this used to go say we are successful in doing this, and these people are getting certification or advancing in their position or something, because this is a low-cost way to really help people who don't have the time or the necessity to come back here for credit courses. And we have a laboratory that COVID gave us.
You're absolutely right.
So let's use that. And it sounds like you're doing it, so thank you.
It's also fascinating because we're able to see what people would take if funding was not the barrier, right? So that we're able to see what their true interests are, what areas they're interested in pursuing, and of course compare that to the job environment. And I think a lot of that data we did use in the grant application to Johnson County for this current round. We gave them a lot of the data of what occurred last time, as well as for Casey Scholars. But I think the certifications are probably the most telling, and that number has increased. So we will make sure to have some of that for your information as well.
Thank you.
But thank you.
Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Yes.
Trustee Ingram, I would just add to that, and I appreciate you bringing that up, Trustee Musil, because I think that would be really a nice piece for student success, just to have a short report, if you would, at some upcoming Student Success Committee meeting too, and then we can bring that back to the board. So I think it's great. Appreciate it. Thank you.
Anthony, are there any other questions or comments in the room?
I don't believe so. I think we're good.
Just a few quick points. Thank you, Trustee Ingram. One, I just want to clarify, there is no JCCC JET, right, that I'm aware of?
That is correct.
Okay. I just wanted to
know of, Mr. Chair.
Yeah. I heard you say that, and I'm like, oh, God, somebody's going to think we have a jet, like, laying around. I'm like, no, that's not the case. Number two, Mr. President, I appreciate your words, and I wrote it down as the quote, as I understood it, access without completion is a hollow promise, and I think that is a wonderful sentence you put together there, and I think something to separate our mission from that of our for-profit colleagues, and I think puts us in line, perhaps in a partnership with somebody else like Kansas State, or to become Kansas Polytechnical Institute, and looked up a definition for Polytechnical Institute here, and I don't know that I fully understand it, but it is essentially an institute of technology that is provides a tertiary education that specializes in engineering, technology, applied science, and natural sciences, which seems in line, I mean, somewhat with Kansas State University, and I think that of, you know, Missouri Tech or MIT or Caltech or a number of other places that, that, you know, really look at what a market needs and how we can meet that in even a technical manner. So I appreciate your leadership on that, the previous administration, and frankly, multiple administrations, and then that of the courage of this board to bend its vision and to be adaptable so that we can provide, you know, what our market and what our students need. So I just want to comment on all that. I appreciate your work, Mr. President, and I'll be quiet unless somebody else has some other question or comment on these points.
Chair.
Hearing and go ahead. Yes,
Chair Cross, the only other thing that I would ask, I appreciated the Community College 3.0. I just want to ask those 5 points that you shared in the last, those all go back to our strategic plan in some fashion, correct?
That is correct.
Okay, very good. Thank you.
Well, I wasn't trying to take that away from you, Trustee Ingram. Your leadership, too. You're great.
We're good.
But you're not blessed.
I'm not blessed.
It's true.
It just slipped out. I'm sorry. You're all a blessing. I appreciate you. Next item, Mr. President, does that conclude your report? I'm sorry.
It does. Thank you very much, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Mr. President. And the next item we have is new business. And at my request, President Bowne has included a point here on the agenda with respect to trustee committee assignment. And we selected as a board Trustee Rail back in January to rejoin our board, and she agreed and frankly beat out a very stiff set of applicants to become a trustee again. So I had asked Dr. Bowne, and in consultation with Trustee Ingram, to reappoint or to appoint Trustee Rail, essentially. And I get these new committees confused. I know Laura Smith Everett's laughing at me, but I think I had asked Dr. Bowne that we put Trustee Rail back on what used to be HR. Is that now, that's not management and finance, no.
Employee engagement.
Development.
Whatever that means, right. Like human resources, I guess, is too corporate-y. But we went with employee engagement. So I would like to put Trustee Rail there. I think I have the authority to do it, but frankly, I'd rather have the approval of this board to put her there. Dr. Bowne and I had perhaps anticipated there be, if there's any disagreement with it or if anybody would like extra committee assignments, those are available to you. I mean, we can kind of do whatever we want to up to 3 trustees. But as a matter of full disclosure and my thoughts on this, and for those that would like more of my time and thoughts, I may be flattered be constricted by the Kansas Open Meetings Act, but we can't always talk as much as we'd like, but I do appreciate the time many of you, particularly the administration and Trustee Ingram gave me on this topic. Trustee Rail is a colleague, and I went to law school with her, and I have a high respect for her, so I'd like to include her on this committee along with Trustee Ingram and Trustee Hamill. Because they'll have an institutional knowledge to bring her up to speed. And, you know, Trustee Rail is sharp. She doesn't need that much time to get caught up. But I'd like to include her on that committee. And, frankly, I'll make that motion if I can have a second, please.
Would you clarify? You are making the motion?
Yeah, I didn't think it was confusing, but I would move to include Trustee Melody Rail to the Employee Engagement Committee, effective immediately, and that is my motion.
This is Trustee Musil, Lee. I don't remember. We just revised the bylaws, but I don't remember. But if it requires a motion and a second, I'll certainly support it. I think that's one of the discretionary actions of the chair to fill out those committees as we go along. So I will support the motion.
I certainly appreciate that. I just, you know, I've tried to
govern or direct this board in a collegial flat hierarchy. So my desire here is just to bring it to you all, include you here in a public manner so that we, you know, Trustee Rail, is my understanding your law career has involved employment-related issues. So I thought the committee was a natural fit. She's a better lawyer than I am, so I just like to have her on this committee. And there's really no agenda here beyond that. She has experience. I like to put her there. Many of us could benefit. I don't have her experience. Many of us could benefit by watching her do it. So the motion has been moved by myself and seconded by Trustee Musil. Is there any further discussion? I'll open it up now.
I have some.
Chair Cross, I'll just briefly comment. Thank you very much for making that motion. I appreciate it. And I will, of course, abstain from the vote. But it would be my pleasure to serve on that committee and bring what experience I have in the employment arena to the committee. So thank you for that.
Thank you, Madam Trustee. I know there's some other comments, maybe.
Yes, Mr. Cross, Trustee Hamill.
I have a couple questions and maybe even a concern. Having three on one committee, is there any way we're going to be in violation of any kind of COMA rules at all, possibly with having discussions if we want to bring
that I'm aware of, but
panel? And is there anybody who is everybody serving just two committees, or is there people serving more than two?
If I could take a swing at that, I don't believe we're in violation of COMA. Another lawyer smarter than me is Kelsey Nazar. I would defer to her, but I don't think so. With respect to serving more committees, as long as we're under four trustees, I think we're good.
Well, my concern is, we go to the meeting, we have our discussion with three people on there, and then we say, hey, you know what? I want the expertise of a K-12 teacher or something and want to talk to Laura about it. I mean, what would that still be appropriate, or at that point in time, or having those kind of discussions?
I think if it's an open meeting already.
So then that won't be a problem then if it's an open meeting.
Well, and when you report out, you will be reporting to the board, and at that time, that's a good time for that kind of discussion as well. So you still have that opportunity.
Okay. And while I'll be hesitant to speak to Kelsey Nazar, our general counsel, my guess is she would say in a public meeting that's publicly posted as a meeting, we would be fine. It's the offline conversations that create the risk.
Mm-hmm. No, that's my concern. So basically, if we have the meeting with three, having a conversation outside of the boardroom at all would be just basically don't do it almost because you're, and that's my concern with having three on one panel.
I mean, I will just speak to the advice when I was on in the former committee structure, because there was one committee I was on, I think it was HR.
Management,
where there were three of us. So as long as you're doing your business in public, you're fine. And if at any point you do have a side conversation, you have that side conversation within the restraints of the three people on that committee, you're still following COMA. It's when you get the fourth person.
You can't talk to anybody
else. So you just don't do the chain communication, and you keep it all in an open public meeting. That was, yeah.
Hey, Mr. Chair, I think if I remember right from the committee assignments, we didn't have our seventh trustee when we made the committee assignments, and I think Trustee Rail was only on one committee.
So this
would put her on a second.
That was committee. My clarifying question. Yeah. This is only her second committee, isn't that right, Mr. Chair? This just now puts her on two because we're all on two.
Okay.
That's my understanding, and I didn't articulate that well, so thank you both for filling in those facts. Yeah. Yes, that's my understanding. We're in this unique spot of replacing trustee. We have a new trustee. But that was just me working to deploy the talent we have on this board where we need it. If anybody has any issue with their current assignment, I'm happy to reconsider and or redeploy or give you more to do. Following custom and tradition, I'm not on any committees myself, so I work to pay attention. I couldn't make February the entire committee day, but I have been in full attendance in January and March for our committee meetings.
just to know what's going on and have some idea of what's on the agendas. But my goal here is just to fill out a roster and put Trustee Rail where her strengths are. So
I think we're all supportive of Trustee Rail suffering through two committee meetings just like the rest of us.
So unless there's any... And I will note that Trustee Rail was a former chair of this board. She was chair when I started. And at any rate, I'll call the question unless there's any other discussion.
We have a motion and a second, right?
We have a motion.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
No opposed. The motion passes unanimously in the opinion of the chair. Thank you all for that.
I think Trustee Rail wanted her vote reflected as an abstention.
Yeah. Oh, right.
Is that right, Melanie?
Good point.
Very good.
That's correct.
So that'll go down as 601, right?
7-0. Mr. Chair, I think we're ready.
Okay, good. I was not sure if people are still doing math or not. I didn't hear anything back. The next item on our agenda is old business. I don't believe we have any old business, Dr. Bound, do we?
That is correct.
We'll move on to the consent agenda. The consent agenda you can see on your agenda and in your board packet. Is there any item any trustee would like to pull off of the consent agenda where we can discuss separately? And if not, I would entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda.
I move that we approve the consent agenda.
I'll second. That was
the motion.
Rattan.
The motion was moved by Trustee Rattan and seconded by Trustee Ingram. Any discussion on the consent agenda? Hearing none. All those in favor, please signify by saying yes.
Yes.
And those opposed. Hearing no opposition, the motion passes unanimously. I believe that is near to the end of our meeting here. I know that we have two executive sessions to have this evening. I don't have the script in front of me. I probably didn't open it, or I don't know where it's at. But
Mr. Chair,
I know we'll go ahead.
I do have that in front of me. Would you like for me to take care of that?
That would be grand. Yes, please.
Are you all right with that? Okay. Yes. I would like to entertain a motion to go into executive session for consultation with legal counsel regarding a pending personnel matter, which would be deemed privileged in the attorney-client relationship. No action will be taken during this session. The executive session will last for 30 minutes, beginning at, should we say 7:10? All right, 7:10 and ending at 7:40. At which time open session will resume at this location for those present in person and by Zoom video conference for the rest. Invited to join this executive session are all board members in attendance, Dr. Andy Bound, Dr. Mickey McLeod, Colleen Chandler, and Kelsey Nazar.
Did you make that as a motion?
That is, I would like to entertain a motion. And I so move.
Second.
Sorry.
Motion's been moved by Trustee Ingram and seconded by Trustee Musil. Any opposition? Excuse me. Any discussion? Any discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
And those opposed.
Aye.
In the opinion of the chair, the ayes have it, and we'll adjourn until 7:10 Central.
Thank you. We have reconvened at 7:40 p.m. this evening. No action was taken during the executive session. At this time, I would like to entertain a motion to go into executive session for consultation with legal counsel regarding a pending personnel matter which would be deemed privileged in the attorney-client relationship. No action will be taken during this session. The executive session will last for 30 minutes, beginning at 7:45
and ending at 8:15 p.m., at which time open session will resume at the same location for those present in person and at by Zoom video conference for the rest. Invited to join this executive session are all board members, Dr. Andy Bound, Dr. Mickey McLeod, Colleen Chandler, and Kelsey Nazar. And I will make that motion.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to go into executive session. Mr. Chair?
All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
And those opposed? No.
We will go into executive session at 7:45 and return at 8:15. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
During that time, at this point, I would turn it over to Trustee Chair Cross to adjourn.
I thank you for confusing me with Greg Musil. It's an honor.
I'm sorry.
We've come out of executive session, as Trustee Ingram said, in which no action was taken, and I would entertain a motion to adjourn now, if I may.
So moved.
Second.
The motion has been moved by Trustee Smith Everett, as I heard it, and seconded by Trustee Ingram. All in favor, please signify by saying yes.
Yes.
And those opposed? Thank you all. This concludes the March 16th, 2023 meeting of the Johnson County Community College Board of Trustees. Happy St. Patrick's Day to everybody and spring break.
Thank you.